Everyone, welcome back to the Purl Up and Dye podcast. This is episode 9, if you can believe it. I can't. I can't believe I still have people liking and commenting on my podcast, so that's really exciting. But okay, so this is episode 9. I think it might be a little bit of a shorter one. I'm kind of racing against the clock today. My sister so kindly offered to babysit my littlest one because she's not in school today, so I could do this. So I'm kind of like needing to reprieve her because Laura's a very active child. So I'm in a hurry. So hopefully it'll still be all right, put together okay for you. So anyways, my name is Jaedyn. I'm coming to you from Saskatchewan, Canada. It's still winter here. I guess it's February, so it's winter everywhere, but ugh, you know, I don't know what it is. Is it February for everybody else? Is it that month where it's just like, you're done with winter? So March is on its way. We get winter till May, so we still got a while, ways to go, but I am starting to go squirrely. I'm wanting to see some melting snow, although it's supposed to get into the pluses this week, so it's going to melt, and then it's going to freeze, and then we're going to have ice, and I should be careful what I wish for. It never works out well. So anyways, rambling. You can find me around the internet as Little Prairie Purl. You can find me there on Instagram. That's my main account on Instagram. You can find my shop at littleprairiepearl.etsy.com, where I sell knitting bags and sassy knitting tags, a few patterns, nothing major. Ravelry, I'm Creations on a Whim. And most recently, my sister and I started up a yarn shop, or like an Etsy hand-dyed shop. And you can find that at midknitcravings.etsy.com. And I will put all the links below. So this week on the podcast, I'm going to show you what I've been working on, which is pretty much nothing. let's just be honest here. I haven't had it any time. We launched our shop 2 weeks ago, and since then I have pretty much not knit. So I'll show you what I have started. And yeah, maybe I'll talk a little bit more about the knit along that, or the craft along that Megan and I are going to do. And since she spilled all the beans here, I was trying to be coy. Megan. I'm just kidding. Funny. So anyway, I crack myself up. But yeah, so I'll maybe talk a little bit more about that. That's going to be coming up fairly soon. Oh, I have a Wish I Knew segment. I've had a few people ask me about the weight, like differences of weights and stuff like that. I do intend to do that segment. Just this week, I just didn't have time to really fully prepare it. That is on my agenda, and I promise I will do it, because I found when I was a newbie, I had no idea what the difference between fingering and worsted and bulky. I mean, I kind of figured I knew, but it's always good to get a refresher. Or if you don't know, it's good to learn that. So that will not be this week, but it will be coming up, I promise. But this week's Wish I Knew, I'm going to talk about Lifelines, just because I'm working on a shawl. I probably won't be inserting a Lifeline in this one, but I will. It's the perfect opportunity to show you how to do it. So there'll be a shop update as well. At the very end of my podcasts now, since I have a yarn shop, I'm going to do an insert about what we've been working on, what colorways are available in the shop. If you don't want to watch that, that is 100% fine with me. I understand that not everybody is here to see the yarn that I've dyed, or, you know, aren't interested. So that's okay. So I will let you know when that is going to come up, if you want to leave. So, oh, and what I'm drinking today is my standard. Got coffee with cream. So good. So I don't know what to start with. I would show UFOs, but I don't have one. Yeah, it's been a pretty crappy knitting 2 weeks. I haven't even worked on my poor little kid's blankets. You know, my crochet gratitude blanket. It's like, oh, I've been so busy. But anyways, enough about that. So I have really nothing to show you for knitting content. Welcome to my knitting podcast, where I have no knitting on it. Oh, well. But I apologize already. It's going to be It's going to be short and sweet this week. Maybe. We'll see. I say that every week, and then it turns out to be an hour, so I will try. Okay, so, why don't I start with a knit-along then? Because may as well get into that. So, as I mentioned before, Megan and I, you'll maybe know her as Knitter's Party Podcast. She has a YouTube podcast. Put her links down below, as I always do. But we've decided that we're going to co-host a knit-along. It's going to start in March, so you've got some time yet to think about it. It is going to be a budget-based knit-along. So you cannot use an inexpensive yarn. So most hand-dyed yarns, Malabrigo, Madeline Tosh, luxury yarns, sorry. We're looking for stuff that is like under $10 a ball, preferably cheaper, because I mean $10 and then you get a like 25 gram ball, that's not really a cheap yarn, right? So, and it has to be substantial. You cannot be making like, oh, I bought a ball of cotton for $2 and I made 4 washcloths. No, sorry, there's nothing wrong with washcloths, but we would like you to see something like to really stretch the limits on what you can make with this budget yarn. Like, I've made a shawl for my mother-in-law. It cost me $3.99. It was wool-like yarn. I think it's loops and threads. I got it at Michael's for $3.99 Canadian, so it's probably cheaper in the States, without a coupon. And it gave me 400 and something yards. I made her an entire shawl. So, and it was beautiful. It wasn't an ugly shawl at all. So, I've shown it in another podcast. It was red. It was by what is her name? Aroha Knits, Francois. And she did, it's one of her patterns. I loved it. So we're looking for stuff like that. I mean, not necessarily a shawl. We're not going to tell you what you can and cannot make. But we just want it to be something like maybe some socks or some shawl, or if you want to attempt a sweater, that would be great. I don't believe you have to finish. I think that's what we decided. You don't have to finish, because who's going to knit a whole sweater in a month? Nobody has, well, okay, I'm not going to say nobody has that much, you know, speed or time, but maybe some of you do. And if you do, great. But I don't think we have to finish, but you have to do a substantial amount. Some other interesting little tidbits. We're going to have a prize. The grand prize is going to be a $25 gift certificate to KnitPicks, because they're our favorite budget yarn company. And then Megan has a pin, I believe, that she has picked up in Egypt that she was going to gift. And we're also going to give away a couple of prizes of a pattern of your choice under a certain dollar amount. We haven't discussed that yet, but from Ravelry. So that will be coming up. Stay tuned for more details. There'll be some information in Megan's, I can't talk today. I haven't had enough coffee. Megan's Ravelry group and one in mine. And we're going to do it so that like a chatter thread is in mine or hers. And then the opposite, like the finished object thread, will be in the opposite person's, so that you have to be a member of both of our groups to be eligible for prizes. And we're excited. We think it's going to be a lot of fun. I always worry that what content I have in my knitting podcast is of no interest to other people, because I'm a budget knitter. I work with a lot of knit picks, and it's not maybe the most interesting, but I've been getting a lot of good feedback that people are really enjoying it, and that it's nice to see somebody who can work, you know, with this much money and still make really nice things. So I've been really enjoying that. I'm really glad that this is something that everybody else finds informative and enjoyable. So, yeah. Oh, I never said welcome to all my returning viewers and welcome to my new viewers. So welcome, everyone. yay. Welcome to my very rambly podcast today. It is obviously not very well thought out, but yes, so Megan and I will be doing that. We'll be starting it in March, like I said, and so start thinking now about what you may want to do. I think it'll be a lot of fun. I have no idea what I'm gonna knit or crochet. I have no clue. I have to go stash diving. But it will be fun. I'm looking forward to it a lot. So that's that for kind of admin stuff. I don't really have anything. So knitting wise, I'll show you what I've been working on. I started it yesterday, so I mean, it's not like I have a ton to show you, but I don't know. I've got like starter-itis. I want everything on my needles now, and I just don't even have time, so it's kind of crazy. But right now, I'm working on, I've started a new shawl, and this is going to be the, it's by Lisa Much. I'll have to put a link. I can't remember the name of it. I just said it this morning and now I can't remember, but I'll put the link in. It's actually, it's a pattern that she just recently gave for free on her Ravelry account. And, I suck today. This is not good. Okay. She gave it away for free on her Ravelry account. And then it's actually a garter stitch shawl. But I have a lot of those already, and I just kind of wanted something more, I don't know, just looked a little different. And I didn't really care how this yarn was working up in a garter stitch, so I switched to stockinette. And I also changed the way that she does her increases along the edge. So by the time it's done, it might not even look anything like hers, but that's the jumping off point. But I'll put the link in down below. But this is all I have so far. So you start with your like a few stitches and then you just do lots of increases. And I mean, it kind of looks like right now it's, as shawls do, it kind of has a peak, but once you block it and you stretch it, it kind of straightens out this top so that it's barely noticeable. I mean, you know, all this pinning, but anyways, the yarn I'm using is some of the stuff that I have dyed myself. I've got a later on when we have an announcement about a new yarn that we're going to have. Oh, I'm so excited. This was take number one, and it turned out too pastel. I wanted it a lot bolder, but I love this color so much that I will be offering it as a colorway. I keep saying I, because I dyed this particular one, but we, my sister and I, will be offering this in our shop. But it's like silver and soft pastel-y peaches and like a mint and a corally, no, not coral, like a robin egg blue, and then there's speckles in it. It's so pretty. And I don't normally do pastel, I do bright, but I don't know, something about this yarn. And I'm going to pair it with one of these. So this is a pink mimosa, it's one of the R colors, but it works really well with this. You know what, every week I tell you guys I'm going to get better at this and I get worse. I need to just stop saying that. But anyways, this is, like I said, this isn't offered in our shop yet, this color. It will be after, you know, in a month or so when I get some other stuff going. But this is it here in the ball. So like I said, it's mostly silver. Oh, and it's on this, our sugar base, which is our sparkle. And you guys can't, I don't know. Oh, there we go. Can you see how sparkly that is? It is insane sparkles. It's got 16% stellina in it, which makes it like ridiculously sparkly. I love it so much. But anyways, so this is what I'm working on. I wish I could tell you the name of the pattern, but I changed it so much that I don't know if it'll really even matter. But that's pretty much all I've worked on. I have the girl from the grocery store shawl. I've barely worked on it. I finished my daughter's one Felici sock. It's over there. Otherwise, I'd go get it, but it's just beyond my reach. I'm too lazy. And I'm like very precariously set up here. So if I move, I might knock some coffee over or, you know, hit my laptop, which has to just sit just so. Otherwise, it stops charging. And oh my goodness. I swear, awkward, but I don't dare go get it, so I'll show it next time. Maybe I'll have an FO by then, I don't know, but okay, so that's pretty much all I have for knitting content today. Sorry. So why don't I go into my Wish I Knew segment, and I'm going to talk a little bit about a lifeline. And if you've never heard about lifelines, what they are when you're knitting, you know, especially a lot of people use it when they're knitting something complicated like lace. When you finish a repeat and you know it's right because your stitch count is right, it all looks good, sometimes they'll put in a lifeline. Or right before they go to do a lace insert, like a lace section of their shawl, they'll put in a lifeline. So that in case you screw up or you make a major mistake or you drop stitches or something, you then have like something to catch all those stitches in case you have to rip out your knitting. Because if you got this much of a shawl done and you make a huge mistake, a lot of times new knitters don't know how to fix it. And I am guilty of this, where I've taken like an almost completed shelf and it screwed it up right near the end, and I ripped it all the way back to the very beginning because I didn't know how to fix it and the stitches wouldn't stop running. So enter a lifeline, and so handy. It'll change your life, I swear. Okay, so the easiest way to do it, I think, will be just to show you. It could be a little bit awkward here because you can't see my knitting, but I'm going to basically teach you what to do. Okay, so let's say, okay, I'm ready to start an insert, lace. I'm not, but we're just going to pretend for the sake of the video. Okay, so here we go. We're ready to do a lace panel. We know these stitch counts are right, and we don't want to lose all of this in case we screw up our lace, okay? We're at the end of a row. Where's my yarn? Here it is. Okay, so you're going to take a piece of scrap yarn. I prefer cotton when I'm working with wool because it doesn't stick against the wool. If you use a wool lifeline, it might stick to your wool on your needles. That's annoying. So what I'm going to do, I like to use cotton if I'm using wool. You know, you can get, some people call it crochet cotton, or it's just that thin, shiny, slick stuff that people like will make doilies out of and stuff like that. But anyways, take a nice big length, much longer than your finished piece, because you want to have a long end dangling out the side. Okay, scissors, put your safety caps on. Swinging the scissors around and there's yarn everywhere, I should know better. Okay, so I use interchangeable needles. I've talked about them on previous podcasts, but what I love, oh my goodness, this isn't an intended thing, but it's amazing. There's a little hole. I don't think it's going to focus. Oh, there, you can see it. Okay, so you see that little hole there. That little hole is made so that you can put the cable key in, so you can tighten your needle to your cable. But it also works excellently for running a lifeline. Okay, I always do that. Sorry if it grossed anybody out, but I always lick my yarn. I do wash my products when it's done, and this isn't going to stay in there. But okay, what you're going to do is with that hole, you can run your string through it. So you see how I've got my string through there? So you just, okay, put a length through. Now you're going to just knit like you normally do. I love this trick. I learned it on Ravelry, and it just like blew my mind. It is so awesome. Okay, so I'm just going to knit a little bit for you so you can see what I'm doing. And you just follow your pattern. Don't worry about the string that's now hanging off your work. Okay, so I'm just going to purl across this row. Maybe not all of it because it might take me a while. But I'm a continental knitter. And so purling, actually, I'm actually a faster purler than I am a knitter. This movement is actually a little less for me. So, oops, drop a stitch. Don't want to do that. I've tried knitting English style. I don't know. I say it's because I was a crocheter first that I'm a faster, or like I'm a continental knitter. But because it was just a natural motion for me to hold my yarn in my right hand, or my left hand, sorry. But I know that's not true for everyone. My sister is a crocheter and she crocheted far longer than me, and she is an English style. She throws her yarn. I don't know. She might be closer to like what the ones that call themselves flickers. I haven't really watched her knit overly a lot. She's a beginner, but she's actually quite speedy at it. So, but she does it with her right hand. So go figure. I can't say that it's one way or another. So if you're a new knitter and you're struggling with your knitting, being with your speed, I highly recommend trying out both ways, because I taught Tara, I said, well, let's try it continental because you're going to, it'll probably be more natural for you. And she had found it the other way. So she did try it continental, but she found that she was all thumbs. So just because if you're struggling with one way, switch hands, because you just never know, one way might be more natural for you. And you might find something that you enjoy more. Like I said, I far prefer doing continental. And I'm almost at the end of my row, so I'm just going to finish. Yeah. And I'm experienced enough now that apparently I can look at myself while I can watch the podcast. I knew that I could do that. That's a surprise to even me today. Never stop learning stuff, eh? But, okay, so close. Almost at the end, almost there. Thanks for hanging on to while I knit this row. But now I can show you exactly. I was going to stop halfway through the row, but this will actually work out better. And so like I said, this was a trick that I learned on Ravelry. I didn't even know such things existed, or that you could run it through your cable. And I use Lifelines all the time, because there's nothing more disheartening than having to rip back. And if you do have to rip back, then you've always got that nervous, like, oh no, what happens if a stitch runs and I don't know how to pick it up? Especially if you've got any lace. But okay, so I'm now at the end of my row. I do have some string hanging out this end. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to just pull my needle through, find that, and I'm going to remove it from that hole. Like this. And now you have, can you see that? Is it focusing? You can see that string is now through every single stitch on your needle or on your cable. So now if I did something like this, and I lost some stitches. Oh no, I lost stitches. So you see how they're all hanging there? They're all on a string. So you don't have to worry about, oh crap, I dropped a needle or anything. See? Now you just, to get those, you just, you see the ones hanging on the strings there? You can just go through and you can just pick them all back up. So, huge time saver. So if I did, every time the phone rings, every time, I'll be right back. Okay, sorry about that. All right, so I answered the phone. There was nobody there. Telemarketer probably, of course. But I also put the stitches back on my needle, because I just didn't want a bunch of stitches hanging there. So that's how you use a Lifeline if you have a if you have interchangeables that have that hole. So what about if you don't have an interchangeable where it will do that for you? So all you're going to do with that is you're going to take yourself a tapestry needle. I prefer the straight ones over the bent ones. Let me just show you the difference. Here's one and here's the other. Okay, so you can get tapestry needles that are straight, and some that have this little bent end. It would help if I showed it to you the proper way. You see that one? It's got this little bent end piece there. I don't know. I find this one a little bit awkward picking up stitches, but this one works really well with the straight. So you're just going to run your length of yarn, your scrap yarn, through the eye, and then you're going to just run the needle through each live stitch that's on your cable. So like right here, for, you know, example, if I had string on here, I would just run it through. Make sure you're hitting every single stitch right through there, you know, every live stitch that's on there. And then when you get to the end, you just leave a long length, a good long length, because you don't want that, you know, because that string is going to naturally start moving back and forth a little bit as you're knitting your next row. You do not want it to slide out the other end. It would defeat the purpose of having the lifeline in. So you just be careful with that. And then you knit your next bit. And like I said, if you mess up, then you can rip it back. And then you have something catching all those live stitches. So you don't have to worry about it dropping a stitch or having it run or, you know, whatever. Huge time saver. I can't remember the first shawl that I used it in, but it just, it was awesome. I loved it. Yeah, so highly recommend that. That's, I guess that's it. I wish I knew. That's it for that segment today. So hopefully that tip helped some of you. Don't feel like you need to only use a lifeline if you're doing lace. You can do it if you're doing a stockinette, anything. You can run a lifeline anytime, maybe when you're moving to the next step of a pattern. Or if you've been, like, even simple patterns, sometimes it's super helpful to put in a lifeline. With the girl with the grocery store, or girl from the grocery store shawl, I keep messing up my stitch counts because there's a, on the first part, you do an increase, and on the same row at the end, you do a decrease, and then when you switch your rows, you do an increase, but not a decrease. And I don't know, when I get mindlessly knitting, and I miss one of those, and then my stitch count will be out. And it's a garter stitch, so it's not a big deal if this, but when I get to the lace panel, I need to have X amount of stitches on my thing. And because it is garter, it's a very difficult for me to find where I've made the mistake. So I end up usually ripping back to like the last point where I knew my stitch count was right, which is usually at a stripe. I should be using lifelines at those stripes so that I don't, because I've just been pulling like live stitches and then just picking up each one, which is scary. And I really should know better, because one of these times I'm going to do it and I'm going to make a mess of it, and then I'm going to be hooped. But so yeah, even in simple things, don't feel silly if you have to use a lifeline. It really helps keep track of things. And yeah, just put it in when you know you have you're at the right point. You've got the right exact stitches. Throw a lifeline in and leave it there. There's no saying that you have to pull this, like, now I've got this lifeline in here. There's no reason I have to take it out. It will just stay there. Oh, the only thing with doing lifelines, make sure you don't run them through a stitch marker. If you're wanting to use that stitch marker again, because it won't come out again until you pull out the lifeline. So if you're using your lifelines and you want to just pull all your lifelines out at the end of your project after you've bound off, you'll have stitch markers all through your work, which is fine. It doesn't hurt anything, but sometimes if you get a stitch marker stuck in your work, and then you can't get it out. So just make sure when you are doing your weaving through, if you come to a stitch marker, remove it and then put it back. Don't run your lifeline through your stitch markers if you can help it, just in case it gets stuck on there permanently. That would stink, you know. Have a beautiful shawl with a stupid stitch marker hanging off of it for the rest of its life. Don't ask me how I know that. Thankfully, most of the stitch markers that I use are just like those little teeny weeny like hair ties that, like, for babies. So if I do get one stuck in my knitting, it's like, whatever, I just snip it out. But if you're using like a metal progress keeper or something like that, well, how do you get that out? Like, there's no way you'd have to take like little tin snips or something. That would be disappointing. So there's a tip for you. But yeah, so that's lifelines for you. A little quick and dirty about that. And I think that's pretty much it. Like I said, it's going to be a really short one, guys. I just really haven't had time. And if you want to stick with me and watch the shop update, you can see why I haven't had any time. If you've been watching that behind me, that is part of my shop update. And so is not the on-air sign. That right there. No. I can't do it. It's opposite. I'm looking backwards at myself. So sorry. The thing right there over my shoulder, that is a sneak peek. So you guys have seen it first. It's going to be a pre-order and it's coming up right away. So if you want to stick with me and watch, I will have a Midknit Cravings update starting right away. So for any of you that may have missed it or just want a refresher, my sister and I started the yarn shop, and we are found on Etsy at midknitcravings.etsy.com. Right now we have a lot of fingering weight selection. We're trying really hard to get some new colors into the shop. We're dyeing a couple of times a week usually. And our goal is to always have a tonal that will match any of the variegateds or the speckles that we come out with. Just for easy pairing, a lot of times people like an option for a solid to go with it for if they're doing a shawl or some socks or something like that. So, and we love a tonal ourselves, so that's what our goal is. If we get a variegated out into our shop or a speckle, we're going to try to always have a tonal to go with. So if you are interested in watching, seeing what we've got, maybe I'll show the variegated first, or the speckle, the colored ones, and then maybe what matches with it. So the first up, we're going to show you this one that Tara created. Oh my goodness, I love it so much. This one is called Skipping Stones. Hopefully it focuses. You know, I was doing so good and it was focusing. But it's a speckle, but it's also, we've allowed the colors to kind of like blend and bleed a little bit. So it's got like this turquoise blues and this, it's actually got velvet plum. It looks like it's gray. It does have some gray in it too, but it does have little flecks of purple, which I love so much. So we matched it up with this one, and it's called Beach Glass. So we've got Skipping Stones and Beach Glass, which go really nicely together. But it also, like I said, it works really well with velvet plum. So if you're wanting, you know, a higher contrast, it goes really well. I still have some Girl Next Door in our shop. So this one goes really well. It goes really well with Beach Glass as well, because it's got a lot of the same colors. And it goes really well with Pink Mimosa, which is one of my favorite color combinations, those two. What else have we got? This is a new one that we just released the other day in the shop. And, well, actually, we've had it on Sport before, but this is the first time it's been on fingering. This one's called Casual Friday. So it's a gray base, and it's got like the beautiful denim blues and charcoal. And yeah, we love it so much. And it goes really well with this one. It's a blue tonal. This one is a little bit, it turned out a little bit darker than it sometimes does. That's the nature of hand dyed, but the two are actually made to go together, but they don't have a lot of contrast. But the next round, we're going to make sure that we don't have quite as much blue in these. But this one, this is our denim blue tonal, and we named it Mom Jeans. We can both say that because we're both moms, but we really like that name. We laugh so hard. We laugh way too much, which is good. It's a fun thing. But naming names, thinking of names for the shop, we have some things are a little inappropriate. We can't name that, but we have a lot of fun. Okay, so I've got Girl Next Door is done. This one, oh my goodness, I love this so much. This one we based on a picture we saw of some succulents. Both of us love succulents. So we have this. We named it Living Wall, and it is on our sugar base, which is our sparkle. It's got 16% sparkle. I don't know if you guys can tell how incredibly sparkly this is. I don't know why it won't focus. It's supposed to be on auto. Maybe I did something wrong. It was focusing earlier. There we go. But yeah, look at how sparkly that is. That's amazing. So this one coordinates with this green, which we named Lettuce Wrap. It's maybe blowing out a little bit, but it's a limey, bright, fresh spring green. And it also works really good with Mom Jeans. It's got a lot of the same blues in there. So there's those ones. And then the one that we've been having a lot of fun with was is this one here. It's called Blood Orange. And it's just, oh my goodness, we love it so much. It's orange, it's got orange in there. You can see the bright red. It also has like this gorgeous deep purple. It's a highly saturated color, and it works really, really well, which surprised, It worked really well with Velvet Plum. I swear, Velvet Plum is, I think, my favorite. It just works with everything, which is surprising. But, yeah, so that's that there. Together. Oh, I love it. So pretty. So those are the colors that we have in our shop right now. If you go to our shop, these are all in there. Nothing that you see here isn't available. Oh, I kind of lied. Okay, so one thing we've been kind of is struggling with is we obviously don't set out to copy anyone or make a colorway that's similar to anybody else's. We are strictly flying by the seat of our pants, colorways that we're thinking of in our heads, or we'll find an inspiration photo and we're, you know, we'll dye it. So the other day I was, I started out with this gorgeous aqua color, and I was intending on going one totally different direction. I was going to speckle it with certain colors. And right at the end, I went on Pinterest and I found this super beautiful photo. But so I was like, you know what? I'm going to try that. So I took out my dye stocks and I threw some color in. I'm like, oh, I wonder what would happen if I added this color. Oh, and I'm going to throw on some of that color. Oh, no, I'm going to speckle it. And then this one, I'm going to pour it in. And basically, I just went to town in the in the dye pots and I had so much fun. And when I pulled it out, I was like, oh, like I loved it so, so much. And I set it out to dry and I was looking at it and I'm like, that's so gorgeous. And then I'm like, it looks so familiar. Why does it look so familiar to me? And I sat there and I thought about it. And then as I was falling asleep the other night, I'm like, oh my goodness, I know why it looks familiar. It looks so close to a yarn that I just purchased from Tanis Fiber Arts. Hers, when I compare it, she does have more colors in it and more speckles, but it is so close. I don't feel right about selling it. And I've asked on Ravelry, on a dyer's group, and they were like, you know what, you didn't intend to sell it or didn't intend to recreate it. But personally for me, I feel like it's just too close. I'll show it to you. It was a complete accident. I was actually amazed that I was able to even get something close. But yeah, this is what I created. So I'm going to re-dye these because, like I said, I just don't feel right about putting them in my shop since they're similar. But I do understand that as dyers, sometimes we're going to end up with something that's similar to somebody else's, and there's not really that much you can do about that. But like I said, I'm not going to set out take a colorway from another person intentionally. Like now that I know that these are too close, I'm going to redo something with them. And I think I'd feel better about that. But I love them. Or maybe I'll make something for my mom. Hi, Mom. I just found out that she started watching my podcast. She's not a knitter at all. I was a little afraid. I was like, oh my goodness. I've never said anything rude about my mom, so. Not that I would. I love my mom. Oh, but yeah, it just made me laugh so much when she told me, I watched your podcast. I'm like, oh no. Oh, scary. But anyways, so this is them. I don't know. I'm not even going to call it anything. I'm not going to name it. They will not be in the shop. I just wanted to show them off because I thought they turned out really, really pretty, but such is life. And so, yeah. And, okay, so that's that. I showed those. But, you guys, I'm so excited. Oh, my goodness. This has been a colorway that I've been planning on doing for a long time. We are ready to launch it. I mean, I say a long time. We've been in business for a whole 2 weeks. But it's been on my mind before that, like, forever. So, you guys are seeing it first because you're my people. But I'm going to insert a inspiration photo so you guys can see what this is supposed to be. And this is the colorway. So Obviously, from the photo, you guys know that this is a Beauty and the Beast inspired yarn. I am so excited to watch the movie. I am not a Disney kind of girl. I'm not in love with princesses. I didn't grow up being like in love with the Cinderella and the princesses and stuff like that. I watched the movies, didn't really, you know, I watched them once or twice and I was like, oh, that's fine. But I don't know, there's something about Beauty and the Beast that has always been my personal favorite. When I sit there and think of it, it's because I think I could relate to her a little bit. Belle, she's a little bit of an outsider. She's read a lot. Like for me, when I was growing up, I got bullied really badly, especially through like elementary school and early like junior high and stuff like that. I read everything and all the time. I was always in the library reading. I've just felt like I could kind of, I think I could relate to her. She was, you know, reader, kind of an outsider on the, you know, and I don't know. I felt like I related to her, I guess. And she's just always been my favorite Disney princess. And so with the new live action movie coming out, oh my goodness, I'm ridiculously excited. So this set, oh, I love it so much. But so this one obviously is based on the picture of the enchanted rose. We're naming this one The Last Petal. And it is, oh my goodness. You see that there? We've got like the gray, silver, and it's on our sugar. We're only offering it on sugar because I think, hello, Last Petal, that enchanted rose needs some glitter. And it's getting glitter. So, but yeah, we've got some blue. We've got like a shot of red for the rose. We've got the green for the leaves and the stem. We've got a little bit of yellow for Belle's dress right in there. Oh, guys, love this so much. And then as an option, you don't have to, but we're going to put it up as a pre-order for Last Petal. And then we're also going to do an option where you can add a mini of ball gown, which is obviously Belle's dress. So these two together will be an option. So this will be a variation. So you'll just have to click the drop down and choose which one that you want. And these we're doing as a pre-order because I just didn't know how many to make up. So that way we'll know how many we need to dye up. We haven't decided on how many max. I think we're going to start with a 20. So if you like it, feel free to go. I'm going to, by the time you guys see this podcast, the pre-order will be open. So probably maybe tomorrow when I click submit, like once it's done to YouTube, I'll make that that live for you. So you guys can be one of the first ones if you want one of these. Oh my goodness. I'm so excited. I love how this turned out. Ridiculous. But anyways, pre-orders. I really hope that you guys love this too. And that's it for shop updates, I guess, this week. I wanted to just say quickly thank you to all of you who've checked it out, who's favorited our shop. Please feel free to follow us on Midknit Cravings on Instagram. We try to put up something every day, just like an inspiration photo or just something general to chat with you, to show you what colors you can pair with, new things that are in our shop. I will make the announcement there when we have our pre-order up and available. So just check us out. We're super busy and we really, really, really appreciate all your guys' support. Whether you've bought anything or not, that doesn't matter. The likes, the sharing, the comments on our Instagram, or even like the messages that you've sent, that we really, really appreciate them. And so, like I said, we want to thank you guys so much for your support already. It means a lot to us. And I'm not just saying that to be, I'm not just saying that, it's not empty words. We really do appreciate everything that you guys have done for us so far. So with that, I'm going to go. I've got some dyeing to do. Really excited. So we will catch you guys next time. Thank you so much for watching. Bye.